Hi. It's been a while since I went on a recorded nerd adventure. There are some interesting things that I just wanted to talk about. See if maybe they might interest anybody else. I came across a Wikipedia article about an enzyme called dopamine beta hydroxylase. Sounds nice and flashy, doesn't it? And just reading through it, because when I do this, I never know if I'm going to find something interesting or not, so I give it a shot, you know? I just go, I explore. And toward the bottom of the page, there was a link that said, dopamine beta hydroxylase deficiency. And I clicked on that, and I read it, and discovered some really interesting stuff. So before I talk about the deficiency of the enzyme, I should actually talk about dopamine beta hydroxylase. So what I read was that it's a copper-containing enzyme that your body needs a cofactor of ascorbate to use. And ascorbate, that's just another way to say ascorbic acid or vitamin C. So I thought this was really interesting. Because what dopamine beta hydroxylase does is it converts dopamine into norepinephrine. That's important to know and to understand, because these are neurotransmitters that have been studied in relation to psychiatric disorders, things like schizophrenia, psychosis, bipolar disorder, addiction even, things like that, and attention. So they're studying it in relation to ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. So it's an important enzyme. And I already pay a lot of attention to epinephrine and norepinephrine because from my understanding, that's, if you have too much of norepinephrine, you're going to have anxiety and potentially psychosis. That's my understanding. When people bring up dopamine and say, oh, psychosis is influenced by dopamine, I want to start a conversation with them and be like, do you know that it's really elevated glutamate in particular areas of the brain and elevated norepinephrine that are associated with psychosis? The only way dopamine's involved is because it gets made into norepinephrine, so obviously it's important. But, you know, you have to pay special attention to that and not bring any kind of old-fashioned neuropsychiatric or neuroscience kind of bias into it from decades past when research wasn't as far advanced as it is now. So let's get back on track. I clicked on the dopamine beta hydroxylase deficiency link and read the Wikipedia article, and it was so interesting because people who have a deficiency of the enzyme are narcoleptic. Narcolepsy, maybe you've watched those funny videos on YouTube or on the internet anywhere where a kitten is falling asleep standing up or sitting on its, you know, sitting on its bum and its front legs, and it just falls asleep, or a puppy or a baby, and then suddenly wakes back up. That's like narcolepsy. So reading this article, let's see if I can pull it up again. Dopamine beta hydroxylase deficiency is a deficiency of the enzyme that converts dopamine into norepinephrine. So these people have a whole lot of dopamine in their system. A whole lot. It says it causes orthostatic hypotension, nasal stuffiness, and droopy eyelids, among other symptoms. Some people refer to this as norepinephrine deficiency. It's caused by largely increased amounts of serum dopamine and release of dopamine in place of norepinephrine. It's difficult for people with this to stand still for longer than 1 minute. Another symptom is hypoglycemia, low blood sugar, which is thought to be caused by... well, those are big words. Also, prolactin is frequently suppressed by excessive dopamine. This can also have an impact on digestion. People with dopamine beta hydroxylase deficiency may have a paradoxical response to NRI, that's norepinephrine reuptake inhibitor, antidepressant medication. such as Adronex. They may experience more depression, less energy, and become more sleepy. So, when you get down here to the medications section of the page, and of course, if you want to know sources, all the sources are listed at the bottom of the Wikipedia article, as usual. It says, researchers of disorders such as depression, schizophrenia, and migraines, those run in my family too, are very interested in studying this disorder, as the persons generally have triple-fold amounts of dopamine in their system, and yet are generally normal. So, this antiquated, outdated hypothesis that elevated dopamine causes psychosis, and so they put these people on dopamine receptor antagonists. They block the dopamine receptors in the brain. Well, sometimes the people have less psychosis, sometimes they don't. And then the doctor will go, we'll increase your dopamine blocker medication. The person's going to gain weight. Their appetite is going to be wonky. It's going to change. They're going to experience a loss of pleasure in everyday normal activities. Just not be interested. Not feel any kind of sense of personal reward or like, yeah, I'm so glad I did that. And sure, they've slowed down the rate of dopamine can't be converted into norepinephrine. Sure, but you're not really solving the problem. You're causing the person more discomfort in their life. And they're depressed, and they're not satisfied. It just reduces their quality of life. So I wish that these medications would get with the times. You know? So, having said that, I should mention, something really interesting has been happening. I started taking phosphatidylcholine from, sourced from egg yolk, in capsules. It's not a really high amount. I think it's like 60 milligrams in one capsule. So I usually take two, and it's early in the day, because if I don't take it earlier in the day, if I take it in the afternoon or evening, I'm not going to sleep well. Because it's designed to wake you up, it's designed to keep you alert, improve your attention, improve your memory, that kind of thing. So I take two capsules, so that's, what, 120 milligrams, I think. Hopefully I didn't confuse micrograms and milligrams. And I started taking adenosyl cobalamin, which is vitamin B12, and some days I only take 3,000, what's that, UG? Sometimes I take two of them, so that's 6,000, and they're sublingual. So I noticed, and I've been taking a higher amount of biotin, which is a B vitamin, because I'm trying to see if it can help me with my ammonia issues. So what I noticed after doing that for a week and a half, 2 weeks, is that I am so relaxed, number one, and I'm sleeping better. I'm used to waking up like a dozen times throughout any given night, just because I can't stay asleep. And I've been so accustomed to this for years that I just accepted that that was how, you know, my life was gonna be. I just got used to being easily woken up. And, you know, learning to have a good attitude about it, because why get grumpy or irritable when I get woken up? If, you know, it's something I can expect every night. And just learn to, you know, relax and try to go back to sleep. So I've been sleeping more deeply. I've been having better dream recall. And I'm so relaxed that I haven't had to take as much magnesium. Oh my gosh, like I can go a day without taking it, 2 days without taking it, and I'm fine. It's crazy. Also, I lost my affinity for peanut butter. Like, this has happened to me before with something else. But putting the peanut butter on my tongue and tasting it, immediately I get the signal from my brain, I don't want that. Like, Like, I don't want any niacin. Put that back in the fridge. You don't, I don't want this. Don't give it to me. which makes total sense, because I've mentioned before that niacin, your body makes it from tryptophan and riboflavin, which is vitamin B2. Vitamin B2 plus tryptophan equals vitamin B3, also known as niacin. And when you take it, your body releases serotonin from platelets. And you probably remember that serotonin is made out of tryptophan by your body. From tryptophan to 5-HTP to serotonin. And so I mentioned that you take enough of, you get enough serotonin in your system, you will be laid back. You'll be passive. You'll just be relaxed. And it's a problem because I've had to be drinking green tea more often because it's the only way I could get myself like motivated, like stimulated to do stuff. And I need to be doing stuff. I'm going to be really busy this week. So I just thought that was so bizarre. Like this whole time I really needed to increase, I really needed to be getting phosphatidylcholine. I really needed to be getting active form of vitamin B12, adenosylcobalamin. And like, wow, why didn't I figure this out sooner? Why didn't I try this sooner? And I forget what hunches led me to do that. If I thought about it long enough, I would figure it out. I would remember, but not off the top of my head right now. I don't remember what hunch led me to that. And then I also found out that there's something that a human body makes out of choline that can counteract urea, which also will help me with my ammonia issues. Oh yes, I'm living for the day when I can take off my watch band and it not smell like ammonia. I'm not proud of it. Apparently my mom says my dad has a similar issue. I hope I don't smell awful when I'm sweaty. I hope, man, because that watch band. Anyway, can't remember. Oh, but yeah. That's a really important concept for people to understand, is that you really want, with anything in life, the phrase that was written outside a temple at Delphi was, nothing to excess. So there is a balance to everything. It's possible to get too little of something, to not be getting enough of it. It's also possible to get too much. You need to find that sweet spot. You need to find that middle range of balance where you're able to live your life, function throughout a day at this, just this balanced level of not getting too little stuff, not getting too much of stuff, because too much magnesium, too much niacin, you get a laxative effect from the magnesium. Too much niacin, you will just be so laid back that people will probably call you lazy and slacker and, you know, why aren't you doing anything? just because you're so content. You're like, whatever. I don't care. And that could be a bad thing. It could push you into a state of apathy, of anhedonia, of just like, you know, you don't really care about anything. It's similar to stress. I once watched a video presentation about stress where the presenter, she discussed how she'd sat next to a pilot on an airplane flight one time. He just happened to be a fighter jet pilot, and he and she were talking about how in his job he's trained to operate using stress to his advantage. Like, that's what pilots have to do. They have to make split-second decisions and under, you know, mounting levels of tension, perform, you know, execute. They can't hesitate or anything like that. And so in her presentation, she was talking about how there's an arc, like a spectrum of stress, where if you are not stressed at all, you're not going to get anything done. If you're too stressed, you'll be paralyzed, like you'll be overwhelmed and you're gonna freeze and you're gonna feel like what to do. There's so many things I need to do. What do I do? And you can't make up your mind. You're going to mess up, make a whole lot of mistakes. And then there's a point in the middle where it's just the sweet spot, where you are able to take a stressful situation and perform, respond, do great things. And so you need a little bit of that. You can't be so laid back, so relaxed that you're not capable of functioning. So I think I said everything I wanted to say. But there you go. There's my Nerdventure, my thought trek that I wanted to share with you. If it helped any of you guys in any way, awesome. If it was just like nerdgasm, verbal vomit, I'm so sorry. I hope that your 4th of July was fun. I don't even remember. The night before 4th of July, the morning of 4th of July, there was a thunderstorm that rolled in about 4 a.m. And I remember waking up and not being able to go back to sleep because I forgot to take my magnesium. So I was tense and I was alarmed. And my dad came downstairs a few hours after that, and I realized I'd slept past the time I was supposed to. Because of 4th of July, we have a family tradition of going into town to a breakfast hosted by the Scouts. And I'm like, I'm so sorry, that thunderstorm messed me up, like I could sleep for a whole hour, but I spent a nice few hours with my dad, because my mom wasn't feeling well, so she stayed home, and it's been raining on and off the past few days, which is nice. We need the moisture, we need the rain. And afterward, and during too, but it's nice afterward when it's not raining and you could stand outside and just soak in like the earthy smells, the rain that's still on the sagebrush. It smells just so, it's just aromatic and just calming and inviting. Although I hope that it doesn't keep raining because I need to help my dad finish cleaning out this old little building toward the bottom of the property. And anytime it rains, it gets muddy, and then I can't sweep up, you know, the dirt and debris in there because it just clumps. But it's been really nice weather. Warm during the day, between like 9 a.m. and 6 p.m. warm, then cool in the evening, and then cold at night. Lovely mountain weather.